Greetings from Greece to all participants. I'm very, very honored to be invited today to this enriching and resourceful event. I warmly thank the Institute of Electrical Electronics Engineers Managed Student Branch for this kind invitation. And today we're going to explore the crucial role of STEM education in curriculum 4.0, curriculum of the fourth industrial revolution, since STEM is the future of education, undoubtedly. We're going also to discuss about different innovative approaches to STEM teaching and learning, the necessity to empower girls and women to enter STEM fields of study and careers. And in the second part, I'm going to present some of my multi-award winning projects concerning STEM related to astronomy, physics, and language teaching. So may I share my presentation? Can you see?
Yes, ma'am, it is easy.
Okay. So we are in the age of the fourth industrial revolution, which changes the world around us with robotics, with big data, Internet of Things, and the main challenges are related to the exponential growth of digital tools that include robots, communication systems, and the impact on jobs and industry that these tools are creating is huge. And huge are the opportunities to tap, because we need highly skilled, at the same time, flexible, emotionally, and socially intelligent manufacturing professionals that can solve tomorrow's problems already from today. So futurizing education for building a workforce for enterprise 4.0 will need a more robust professional framework. Education plays an important role in ensuring the skill readiness for the labor force. General education, as well as vocational education, have a critical role to play in making the labor force industry ready. And to take a full advantage of the opportunity created by advanced technology, we need a similar revolution in education. We need to ensure that our students and teachers alike get the best possible teaching learning experiences. And this calls for what we say education 4.0 that address the needs of the fast developing world around us. You know, unfortunately, in most school and colleges so far, we're still teaching subjects in a traditional way with the same old core concept. Although some debates about the evolving future of education in changing times have already begun, there is much action on the ground, because any discussion of the future of work should go hand in hand with discussion of the future of curriculum, and also about those who will deliver it, teachers and faculties. And of course, in the education system of the future, the role of teachers is going to be more of a facilitator and enabler of personalized growth. And this will require a radical transformation in their approach to focus more on what we say outcome-based teaching instead of continuing with traditional ways. And this transformation must also include key areas such as employability, student experience, research excellence, societal impact, and benefit for industry. Today's learners do not need instructor-led educational models, but wish to engage through multiple sources of knowledge at their own pace. And their focus are not just enhanced knowledge, but equally in certain cases even more, the factor of employability and skill development. And this is why the curriculum of the future has to be curated in a way that caters to the evolving needs. So Industry 4.0 has a lot of opportunities for academic institutions to upgrade themselves to the next level. For shaping the expectation of students to meet the challenges of the future, academic institutions would need to design collaborations. Universities, colleges, research centers, government agencies, and corporates need to collectively get involved in the process. Modern learning cannot happen without modernizing delivery. And faculty, as I said before, should go hand in hand with curriculum 4.0. Teachers should focus their efforts on using technological applications that aid cognitive learning abilities, and learning outcomes should be based on personalized adaptive learning techniques. And intelligent digital assets should guide teaching concepts. Teacher-student interaction should be based on a smart approach to make the whole experience engaging and interesting. Institutions can develop an advanced plan to bridge the demand-supply gap of skilled labor in the digital economy. So we need to actually, we are faced with this challenge, the challenge of redefining the curriculum to keep up with the evolution of skills necessary to solve problems, to innovate and succeed. because I believe that as a society so far, we are failing to meet this challenge, and consequently we're failing to adequately prepare next generation for the future, because how will future generations thrive in this changing landscape? How can education and training providers can keep pace with this unprecedented level of change? How does a future proof curriculum look like? Of course, reshaping a curriculum is not an easy thing. It's a considerable challenge, implying complex decision-making processes and various administrative obstacles. Many departments, as I said before, and faculties are still dominated by traditional approaches, while the new industrial age requires fundamentally new mindsets and visionary leadership. The globalized world now needs a more active education system, one that is robust enough to meet every challenge, and this happen only with thoughtful action and proactive involvement of all key stakeholders. And such a transformation, of course, will require gradual efforts from academic leaders with involvement and effort of the government. At the policy level, structural changes in the system might have to be worked out. Opportunities for creating a deeper industry-academia connect will have to be thought also. So what are the levels of this new curriculum of the fourth revolution? First of all, we're talking about the content. Absolutely, we need to upgrade the technical side of the curriculum to accommodate the learning of next-generation robotics, additive manufacturing, smart materials, artificial intelligence, machine learning, Internet of Things, all that. And at the same time, we need to incorporate non-technical disciplines, such as communication or project management, arts marketing, in order to develop cross-cutting competencies and a mindset beyond technical expertise. That means that we need to pay special attention at the same time to the question of ethics, social inclusion, diversity, and sustainability. We need to adopt a holistic approach. And teachers, students, data literacy, because you know how they're bombarded with by a notion of information, they need help to filter all this information. And a learning environment, why learning, how would be this new learning environment apply? Remember, when we talk about STEM education, it's always about problem-based learning, project-based learning, challenge-based learning, inquiry-based learning. So we needed to apply this new environment to stimulate learners to work on challenging real life, offended real life problems, such as the problems that we face in the future, problems for which there are no established answers. Encourage learners to contextualize their theoretical learning in relation to how it would be useful in the world around them. And instead of focusing on standardized thinking, correct answers and objectivity of judgment, creating a learning environment that would stimulate creativity, forming of all opinion and divergent interpretations. So actually we need a culture that accepts mistakes, and could develop the ability in students to turn these mistakes into valuable learning experiences. At the same time, we need to offer experiences, as I said before, relevant to real-world working conditions, for instance, setting or a physical a state in a physical or virtual form. We need also to encourage collaborative learning and stimulate technology-enabled learning, of course. But at the same time, the third level is a level of collaboration. That means that we need to further increase university-industry collaboration in terms of both volume and diversity. Acknowledge the role of industry partners as educational research and employment partners. Create more opportunities for exchanging experiences with other educational institutions. Facilitate peer-to-peer learning and create effective learning ecosystems that engage all key stakeholders. And of course, shift from human-machine interaction towards human-machine collaborations. You know that we are, we talked about fourth industrial revolution, but we are also at the threshold of the fifth industrial revolution. And all the experts of the fourth industrial revolution tells us that this has failed because it has ignored the human factor. So in the new curriculum, teachers should go should maintain their human character while working with machine, and the focus should be on human, on human dimension. Humans should go alongside with machines. What are the new trends in this new educational new curriculum? We said before that most schools teachers teach exact same subject matter. And here we can see during the COVID pandemic also that learning can be taking place anytime, anywhere, that learning will be personalized. That means that students will be introduced to harder tasks only after a certain amount is achieved. And very, very important, the students' opinion, students' needs and interests and requirements should be taken into consideration when we design a new curriculum. And of course, we're talking about more hands-on. STEM is actually, by definition, hands-on experience. And also we're talking about new innovative assessment methods. We have seen during the COVID pandemic how many innovative assessments through technology were developed, and through mobile also, learning the mobile apps, etc. According to World Economic Forum, the top skills in 2020, we have seen here complex problem solving, critical thinking, creativity, all these components of STEM education, and at the same time, emotional intelligence, because I talked about how it's important at the same time to focus on the human factor and support social emotional learning. That means encourage play-based learning, especially primary education. Try to break down learning into smaller coordinated pieces and fostering natural relationships, develop a growth mindset. So we're talking about STEM education, which is the future of education, because as the knowledge is the model that we say knowledge intensive industry model, we must meet existing demand for skills and develop the skills of those who will drive technological change and productivity. So a competitive STEM-based skills is vital to our future as knowledge intensive economy. And STEM projects focus always on inquiries, student-led investigations through open-ended real-life problems and hands-on activities empower students to become out-of-the-box thinkers and creators. Of course, STEM education reflects 90% skills incorporating the four C's, creativity, critical thinking, collaboration, communication. And what are the characteristics of STEM-educated students? They are problem solvers, they're innovators, they're inventors, they're self-reliant, they're logical thinkers, they're technologically literate. And what are the principles of STEM education? Some principles is that learning should be a lifelong process, that learning should include everyday experiences, and students should be involved in research. Of course, new technologies should find the content, and broader sociocultural and political factors should be considered. Now, if we degrade art, we have STEM. Why? Because in 2020, 2021, what we are, when it comes to arming our youth or young people with effective creativity and critical thinking skills, STEM is not enough. So we need to focus on helping kids develop also a creative mindset and other related skills. And this way can give our young people more opportunities to be successful in real world professional settings and problem solving situations. So this idea that we need to teach kids not only to be analytical, but also creative, to be both. To be successful, you need to be at the same time analytical thinking, but also creative thinking. And so we have arts that have been incorporated into STEM teaching, making these projects even more creative and interesting. And why? Because as I said before, we need also to emphasize the value of arts alongside to the economy, alongside science, technology, and mathematics, and how creativity, design, entrepreneurial skills are important because they facilitate problem solving. So we need blended skills. And I want to say, for instance, in primary education, it's impossible to teach science without integrating arts. So I'm going to show you the second part, some examples of my projects, including art. So STEM is an educational interdisciplinary approach that aims to promote research spirit, logical thinking, social skills, autonomy, active participation of students through trial and errors. And actually, STEM education, it's the new trend all around the world now, is a teaching approach that fosters the learner's interest by fostering the individual capabilities of expression, innovation, aesthetic perception, of which innovation is the most important. And many studies have pointed out how that art can help learners to develop their innovation capability by using different kinds of technologies, and how art can improve the development of their cognitive skills, such as listening, thinking, problem solving, as well as their capability of self-expression, observation, cooperation, communication. So STEM education integrates art courses into STEM education in order to balance the science and technology courses and create a more, what we call, inclusive and integrated interdisciplinary education model. Under the basic mathematical logic, along with teaching on engineering and art aesthetics, students can learn the connotations of science and technology, in which art is a personal cognition of beauty, the accumulation of experience, and a process that cannot be replaced by others. The combination of art and STEM education can promote the integration and coordination of various disciplines, and it can cultivate the students' creativity and innovation ability to strengthen their artistic edification and humanistic backgrounds. So STEM education is considered to be now an important national education reform strategy from kindergarten to high school and also university, because it allows students to understand the whole through diverse knowledge and perspectives, which is conducive to cultivating the innovation capability. And STEM education enables learners to learn cooperatively through learning by doing, to solve practical problems through practical processes, and to connect knowledge with real life. It also encourages the use of technology. I think you can see how arts combined with science, and how arts can help us develop thinking skills. That means reasoning ability, intuition, perception, and the relationship, for instance, according to experts, between music and spatial temporal reasoning, as it pertains to mathematical skills, it's important. And also participation in other art forms also leads itself to the development of thinking skills. Social skills also, certain arts activities promote growth in positive social skills, including self-confidence, self-control, empathy, social tolerance, and also reading and language skills. Certain forms of art instruction enhance basic reading skills and language development. And here we can see how arts and science are easily combined because, usually they are seen as two oppositional disciplines with very separate ideas. However, they are not so disparate. They both require observation, they both require intuition, inspiration, passion, dedication, and discipline. Both can inspire each other. And it is surprising that the most important element of research and research networking is creative thinking. Art and science shape culture, and culture shapes how individuals judge the world. They complete each other. So here you can see the first level is the micro level, concerns way in which subjects are structured and options for studying them provided in packages. Measure level, guiding approaches to the constructions of science curriculum and schemes of work that engage learners, and micro level, all these pedagogical practices in science education that can be drawn from the arts. We have talked about educational and robotics applications and the disciplinarity, imagination, creativity, problem solving, as I said before, and very, very important. Here I want to say, I want to clarify two categories of STEM. First of all, we have what we call STEM Unplugged. STEM Unplugged is when you implement a project and you use simply everyday materials that you can find in your house, such as cardboard or Lego. Anything simple and inexpensive equipment and material. And the second part, the second category is entails computational thinking and of course programming, coding, and the technologies such as Arduino, Raspberry, etc. So computational thinking is, we need to bring this STEM education to our classroom because it's a model of thinking. It's important to every student. It's contained in most elements of problem solving that educators constantly teaching the students. And it's a model of thinking that here we can see the components of computational thinking. First of all, have abstraction, seeing a problem, different levels of details. Algorithmic thinking, the tendency to see tasks in terms of smaller connected discrete steps. Decomposition, solving problem involves solving a set of smaller problems. And pattern recognition, seeing a new problem as related to problems previously encountered. And what are the educational technologies that promote STEM education? VR, virtual reality. Very important because it engages students as it is an immersive technology that it has also been used in the game industry. And all the studies show that the virtual environment can stimulate learning and comprehension. There are problems, for instance, there are programs that can help students understand scientific concepts in a more complete way, such as the distribution of forces in electric field, etc. We have clickers or keypads, a classroom technology that allows students to respond and interact through small handheld transmitter. And this have an effective tool, especially in larger classes, because they engage students by enhancing their active participation and enjoyment and increase attention memorization. Internet of like classroom, MOOCs, of course, Internet of things, you don't know about this. And you have also Internet of me, the wearable technologies such as smart watches, smart clothes, which have many pedagogical applications in education because with wearable technologies, learning can happen anywhere, anytime. And the cloud computing provides access to resources that can be requested and configured by the user. And cloud computing can provide e-learning services, virtual worlds, simulations, video streaming. In this way, teachers can create virtual computers, collaboration tools, data storage, and virtual learning environments. So new scenarios, innovation are possible through cloud computing. Now, what are the new, what are the innovative approaches, innovative techniques when we teach STEM, hands-on learning, of course, mini labs, building models, crossover learning, outdoor learning, it's important. This is very, very a new trend in education, what we call outdoor learning. It's interesting to select different multiple settings in order to implement projects. For instance, outside, in a park or in a forest. So in this way, students will be close to nature. They will learn how also to respect the environment. They will learn to make measurements or to experiment with different environmental issues, etc. This outdoor learning or crossover learning could include also field trips and science museum visits and other interesting activities that we can do in order to engage our students to STEM learning. Of course, ICT and learning mobile apps for science that we can leverage, peer-to-peer teaching. There are many strategies that we can leverage, such as create science clubs or science fairs, science exhibitions, science stations, science movies, and also quizzes, interactive quizzes. Always we talk about multimedia approach because we need to stimulate all our senses. So use not only text, not the traditional tests, but try to, for instance, if you want to evaluate your students, try to evaluate them through interactive quiz, because this way they won't understand that it's about evaluation. So all these material, these resources can help us make a STEM lesson more engaging, science lesson more engaging. Storytelling, also role playing, have used this in primary education with great success. Sports-based learning to see what is the science behind. And of course, social media, there are some platforms such as Edmodo, which you have at the same time educational content. So what is the progress so far in STEM education? So far, there has been, of course, a progress, but we need a lot to do more. And later we're going to talk about gender gap, but just now I want to say something that changing the impression that science is for boys and not for men is a huge challenge. And we know that the number of girls and young women pursuing STEM subjects is lower than that of their male counterparts. And this means that we have a STEM workforce with a comparatively low representation of women. So action is needed to ensure that the talent pool for STEM industries is attractive to both men and women. So what happens with STEM in higher education? As I said before, our rapidly society needs highly qualified STEM professionals to develop solutions to the problems. And higher STEM education plays a substantial role in providing such a competent workforce. So we have an interesting study, which is called Relevance of Science Education Role Study, which actually reveals that so far the majority of young people show, unfortunately, a low interest in STEM. Because many students regard the STEM as very difficult and risky, with few practical or creative opportunities. And of course, students who lack a robust self-efficacy in science are easily repelled by this. And also, students lack a sense of relevance of science and technology to environmental issues. They have a lack of training in everyday practices and competencies of STEM professionals, which of course results in low levels of interest and increasing performance among students. And this lack of interest, of course, contrasts with our world's growing problems, which call for urgent technological innovation based on scientific research, such as issues of energy or sustainability, climate change. So this study actually reveals that science, we know all this, that science as it is taught today at all levels of education, it's boring, is uninteresting, because does not help students realize its importance to society, its relevance to society, and the often fragmented manner in which STEM courses such as mathematics or physics or mechanics, electricity are taught does not appeal to students, causes them to lose their interest in science and technology. And also school science does not resemble real world science, does not, therefore does not prepare students to tackle real world problems which often require interdisciplinary applications of competencies from different cognitive STEM disciplines. Classroom practices, on the other hand, that reflect authentic applications of science can positively impact the students' affinity with STEM. So we need to return to an early age of the education system and focus on secondary education from the perspective of higher STEM education. We need to ensure sufficiently high and qualified enrollment in higher education. We need to bridge this gap between secondary and higher education. By how? By showing young people the relevance of science to their personal life and environment. What is the place of STEM in schools? Placing of STEM subject in school is vital to providing a sustainable long-term answer to the shortages we face. So we need an engaging and relevant curriculum According to an annual education skills survey in England, 40% of companies had difficulties in recruiting staff with STEM skills and knowledge over the last 12 months, and over half were expecting problems in the next 2 years. And this problem was particularly acute in sectors like manufacturing and engineering, sectors crucial to the rebalancing of the economy. So we simply do not have enough young people studying these subjects to a higher level or choosing these careers and sectors dependent on them. And this lack of skills in key areas is a big threat, of course, to countries' competitiveness. We need a step change, and this step change has to start from primary education, actually, because according to research, by the time young people reach secondary school, may have already switched off to science subjects, reducing the engagement, limited outcomes, and decreasing the number of who pursue the study of science to a higher level. And what about primary school teachers in science? We have seen that primary school teachers face a set of challenges when they have to teach science. First of all, they needed to find curriculum time. The level of priority given to science, the confidence of primary teachers to teach science, and the related lack of professional development around the subject. There has been a concern about the impact of teachers' weak subject knowledge and low levels of confidence on students' development in science, which actually claims that only highly trained specialists should be teaching the subject to ensure that children do not develop misconception about specific phenomena. Weaker subject knowledge or teachers contribute, of course, to low confidence and poor pedagogical skills. And a teacher, of course, who lacks confidence is impossible to inspire students or change their perception that science is only for brainy people. A survey which was conducted in Australia among pre-service primary school teachers showed on this that we need that pre-service teachers should have experience in STEM, that we need ongoing professional training in STEM education, and then STEM should include school and non-school experiences in STEM-related activities. Here you can see the goals of STEM education programs. All these goals need to reinforce why we need the STEM education program for educators, because we need to reinforce the core science knowledge to enhance their pedagogical knowledge, to improve their ability to conduct experiments, to revise models or prototypes, to develop physical models, to reinforce their skills and promote at the same time, help promote students' 21st century skills. I want to say now, experience how I got involved in the magical world of STEM. I had the chance to participate in a very innovative pioneering program, which is organized by CERN, the European Organization for Nuclear Research. And it's called Playing with Protons. And actually concerns, why it is innovative? Because it concerns teaching of particle physics, in particular modern physics, at the primary school students. So I had as a flexible zone teacher, it was a pilot program then, and I had the chance to run this program. And I had the students of 6 to 12 years old, and I had to teach them particle physics. Of course, it's a STEM-based program, which was organized by SIMS detector, which is located at CERN. It was supported by the European Program Creations, and now it is supported by the Atlas and SIMS experiment, but also the two European programs, Reinforce and Frontiers. And what is the added value? What is the philosophy behind this program? Is that students should be exposed to science at an early age. It is not accidental, no, that CERN organizes STEM courses for students of preschool age and with great success. Why? Because according to recent research, early exposure to scientific phenomena prompts to a better comprehension of scientific terms studied formally later. And in this way, children can understand scientific concepts and reason scientifically. And so all this, for this program, we try to promote STEAM literacy and vision. And what happens there, 10 teachers from Greece and 10 teachers from UK visit CERN installation, and there they get trained, they see training, and they try to experiment with different materials, simple everyday materials that we find in our house, in order to get familiarized with difficult and abstract and complex ideas and concepts of particle physics. When they return to the countries, they have to transfer their knowledge and their experience to their peers, to their students, of course. So what could be the goals of this program? Of course, to invent innovative scenarios, lesson plans to motivate students to get acquainted with new teaching approaches, to diffuse all this knowledge, and very, very important, to feel confident when they teach science. So this actually program allows primary school teachers to enter specialist in science education to create new original approaches that would increase the level of engagement in natural science experimentation and innovation in primary school students. Because teachers who visit science installation draw inspiration, they become very eager to share the knowledge they witness. One of the kind culture of the latest scientific discoveries there in CERN, and they use innovative methods for development of new educational scenarios. Of course, we're talking about this set of skills, which are the component also of STEM education, collaboration, problem solving, dealing with mistakes. And what with a scientific model that we usually use when we teach STEM, it's actually question, where students investigate scientifically oriented question. This is the model that we use to this program. Evidence, students give priority to evidence, analyze, explanation, connection, communication, and reflection. Students reflect on their own progress and their own learning. At the same time, I'm a STEM instructor at the Greek Astronomy Space Company. I'm going to show you later on some photos and examples of my project. And here we try to promote both interest in astronomy, disseminate knowledge in astronomy and astrophysics to the general public through observatory education, STEM educational activities. And we collaborate towards the popularization of a complex concept of astronomy, especially for the privileged children. And here we organize some STEM workshops. We use space themes in order to increase our students' interest in science, to enhance their scientific literacy, to help them acquire some elements of the scientific method, to adopt and develop a scientific attitude towards scientific environment, to help them express artistically, to collaborate and to increase, of course, most important of all, to increase their interest in STEM and science related careers. Why? I want to say here the challenge that I had. You know, when I started this program, first of all, I had to teach it to students of a very young age, 6 to 12. So I had to come up with activities that would be suitable for their age, their interest, their rhythm. Another challenge is that the Greek curriculum does not include modern physics and of course particle physics in the program. So I had to redesign the curriculum, be innovative and creative. I had to select materials that could be attractive for students of this age group. We will see how, we'll show how my students did amazing things, a bit miracles. They performed many scientific and artistic activities. They used materials such as Lego, wood, 3D printing, in order to popularize all this difficult knowledge of particle physics. They depicted the particle semester through a variety of techniques. And, also I have the problem of parents who told me at first when I started this program, it was a same program pilot basis. They told me that I don't want my student of 7 years old to learn particle physics and STEM education and engineering, etc. We had the program, we had some engineering challenges from the particle CMS experiment that we had faced. So they told me that I don't care. So I had these challenges to face. I arranged many pedagogical sessions with parents. I had to convince them about the value of STEM education. And when they saw all the amazing arts and crafts at the end of academic year that students have done, when all students tell me that I want to be a physicist and I want to go to CERN at the age of 7 years old, this was actually the success and the reward of the program. Because remember that our goal is here, of course, the goal of CERN through these programs is not to teach them particle physics in this age. Our goal is to increase our students' interest in science and STEM and science-related careers. When we teach STEM, I always adopt a mixed or eclectic model that integrates elements from various learning theories and methodological approaches, such as inquiry teaching model, constructivism, 5D model of instruction, cooperative learning, and 3D printing. I'm going to show you later how this was very important to our program. And of course, we're talking about interdisciplinarity because cross-thematic integration was fully used. While, for instance, in this program, everything was there, not only particle physics, but also astronomy, physics, chemistry, mathematics, history. Here I want to see what is the difference between interdisciplinarity and STEM, because STEM is a disciplinary approach. When you examine a topic, for instance, an environmental topic, from mythological or historical geographical point of view, this is interdisciplinarity. When you do STEM in one project, you try to involve many, two or more cognitive disciplines. This is what we call also integrated STEM. In one project, you can do many things and you can develop many skills at the same time. This is the magic of STEM. I'm going to show you later what I mean. Many theatrical events, etc. We produced an original material, the visual material that you can find it. It's free in the internet. So what happens now with women? Because this is our main topic today. We can see that science and gender equality are both vital for the achievement of the 2030 agenda, the United Nations Sustainable Development. And over the past 15 years, the global community has made a lot of efforts in inspiring, engaging women and girls in science. Of course, yet women and girls continue to be excluded from participating fully in science. And the 2030 agenda calls a new vision to address the environmental, social, and economic concerns facing the world today. We have a Sustainable Development Goal 5 about gender equality, and of course, 4 about quality education. And in order to achieve full access participation in science for women and girls, the United Nations has adopted a resolution and declaring 11 February as the National Day of Women and Girls in Science. Furthermore, the COVID pandemic has also had a significant impact on scientists, particularly affecting those at an early age career, thus contributing to widening the existing gender gap in science and revealing the gender disparities in the scientific system, which need to be addressed by new policies, new initiatives, and mechanisms to support women and girls. And despite all these significant improvements in recent decades, education is not universally available, and gender inequalities persist. And the major concern in many countries is not only limited numbers of girls going to school, but also limited educational pathways for those that step into the classroom. So this includes how to address the lower participation and learning achievement of girls in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. And STEM underpins the agenda, 2030 agenda for sustainable development. STEM education can provide learners with knowledge, skills, and attitudes required for inclusive and sustainable societies. So leaving out girls and women in STEM education and careers is a loss for all. And historically, the role of women in the field of science has been the background, with exceptions, the work of women scientists has been overlooked, ignored, or attributed to their male colleagues. So too many girls and women are held back by biases, social norms, gender norms, and expectations influencing the quality of education they receive and the subject they study. They are particularly underrepresented in STEM as before careers, and the girls and women systematically tracked away from science and math throughout their education. So at present, according to UNESCO, less than 30% of researchers worldwide are women. And only around 30% of all female students select STEM-related careers in higher education. And globally, female students' enrollment is particularly low in ICT, natural science, mathematics, statistics, and engineering, you can see here, 8%. According to the American Association of University Women, women make up only 28% of the workforce in STEM. Men vastly outnumber women, majoring in most STEM fields in college. And the gender gaps are particularly high in some of the fastest growing and highest paid jobs of the future, like computer science engineering. And here you can see that with the exception of biological fields, in all other fields, male women are underrepresented. You can see here what happens with engineers. So the number of women in science is growing, but at the same time, men continue to outnumber women. And by the time students reach college, women are significantly underrepresented in STEM majors. For instance, only around 20% of engineering majors are women, and only around 19% of computer information science majors are women. And nearly also 80% of healthcare workforce are women, but only about 20% of health executives and board members are women, and only about a third of doctors. And women are more highly represented in lower paying fields, such as home health workers, nurses, and lower paying specialties. 38% of women who major in computers work in computer fields, and only 42% of those who major in engineering work in engineering field. Of course, men STEM salaries are higher than women. The number of women in STEM is, as I said before, growing. The upper levels of these professions in elementary, middle, and high school, boys take mountain-sized courses in roughly equal numbers. Many girls leave high school, leave high school, and does not select STEM as a preferred career. Fewer women pursue these fields, unfortunately. By graduation, men outnumber women in nearly every science and engineering field, and in some fields such as physics, engineering, computer science, the difference is dramatic, with women earning only 20% of bachelor's degrees. So women's representation in science and engineering declines further at the graduate level, and yet again the transition to the workplace. And here what happens here in Europe, among European Union member states, the proportion of female students and engineers varied widely in 2019, ranging from 55% in Lithuania to 28% in Luxembourg. So here we see female engineers were the majority in 13 European Union regions. Five regions of Spain, two regions of Poland, North and Southeast Bulgaria, at the other end of the scale, the smallest proportion of female students engineers was recorded in Germany, Luxembourg. So long-standing biases and gender stereotypes are steering girls and women away from science. We have, for instance, what we call the myth of math brain. Many girls lose confidence in math by third grade. Boys, on the other hand, are more likely to say that they are strong in math by second grade. But research shows that there's no innate cognitive biological differences between men and women in math. And what are the key factors perpetuating gender STEM gaps, gender stereotypes. STEM fields are often viewed as masculine, and teachers and parents over underestimate girls' math abilities. Male dominant native cultures, because fewer women study and work in STEM, these fields tend to perpetuate inflexibly exclusionary male dominated cultures. Girls have fewer role models to inspire their interest in STEM. They see limited examples of female scientists and engineers in books or media or popular culture. And math anxiety, teachers who are predominantly women often have math anxiety that they pass on to girls, and they often grade girls harder for the same work, and assume girls need to work harder to achieve the same level as boys. So students, studies suggest that girls' disadvantage in STEM is actually the result of the interaction of a range of factors embedded in both socialization and the learning processes. This includes social, cultural, gender norms, which influence the way girls and boys are brought up. They learn, interact with parents, with family, with friends and teachers, the wider community, which shape their identity, their beliefs, their behaviors and choices. Girls are often brought up to believe that STEM are masculine topics, and that female ability in this field is innately inferior to that of males. And this, of course, can undermine girls' confidence, interest, and willingness to engage in STEM subjects. You know, in several studies, when children were asked to draw a mathematician or a scientist, girls were twice as likely to draw men as they were to draw women, while boys almost universally drew men, often in a lab coat. It's interesting, this, and evidence also shows that girls' self-efficacy and attitudes related to STEM are strongly influenced by the immediate family environment, especially parents, but also the wider social context. Parents' own beliefs, attitudes, expectations are themselves influenced by gender stereotypes, which can cause differential treatment of girls and boys in care, play, and learning experiences. And parents with a usually higher socioeconomic status and higher educational qualifications tend to have more positive attitudes towards STEM education for girls than parents with lower socioeconomic status, education of immigrant status and ethnic minority background, or single parents. And also media representations of women, status of gender equality societies also has importance. So what do we can do about it? What are recommendations and measures? Education system and schools play a central role in defining interest in STEM subjects and providing equal opportunities. Teachers, learning contexts, materials, assessment, methods, overall learning environment, and socializing so process are all critical to ensure girls' interest and engagement in STEM studies. So it's interesting to see how it's important to raise awareness that girls and women are capable as boys, to promote public awareness to parents, teachers and parents that math skills are learned and change over time, empower girls to embrace challenges, emphasize strong and visible role models of women, provide professional education to teachers, improve STEM education support for girls, encourage girls and women to take math and science classes, ensure every student is exposed to engineering, computer science, change how classes are taught by connecting STEM experiences to girls, promoting active hands-on experiences, teach girls of color math through open-ended and co-created problems. Very important, expand after school and summer STEM opportunities for girls. It's what we call, as I said before, outdoor learning. And increase awareness of higher STEM education and career opportunities pathways. And also the role of universities are important. Universities have an important role to play in encouraging female students to enroll in STEM subjects or to continue in subjects that prepare them for the STEM workforce. They can conduct the gender audits with focus groups, surveys, student attendance, and they actually can promote all this philosophy and inform and encourage girls. It's important, interesting to design courses and change environments and practices for more welcoming, more challenging for women, prioritize diverse, inclusive, respectful environments, a stronger diverse leadership, diffuse hierarchical dependent relationships, and promote mentorship, sponsorship, networking, and corporate mentoring programs. Actively recruit women into STEM careers, emphasize real life applications, and teach about stereotypes, gender norms. I strongly support all these initiatives all around the world that promote the right to empower women into STEM teaching, STEM learning. And here we can see some examples of girls' code coding, etc. And here in Greece, we have many of these examples. We have volunteer teachers who are trying to promote this outside the curriculum. They deliver courses after the normal academic program. And I want to say that I've created, I'm a member of the club G100 Engineering Wing, which is under the auspices of All Ladies Elite. It's actually an organization that gathers and many eminent women around the world that try to promote engineering among women. So we will try to form a group of volunteers that could help students, especially in developing countries, because what I'm trying to do now this period is to promote STEM in developing countries. I'm trying to promote and fighting for the equality between women and men in the field of science. And with my students, we created many radio shows about women science from Marie Curie time to today. These shows were uploaded to the European School Radio. And also we created educational videos. We can find it on YouTube, which were awarded in the European competition Diversity in STEM. And it was about women in science. It was also aired on the national Greek television with the National Women's Day. You can see the portraits here of 30 eminent women in science. And my most recent program, because I'm the founder of many STEM projects all around the world that try to promote positive peace. I'm trying to promote STEM learning to students who suffer from all these advantages of negative peace in Africa and Asia. My recent program is called Gender-Based Violence, Why Peace is a Much Better Option. And it's actually inspired by high rates of gender-based violence in Nigeria. And it's original because it combines STEM education with gender-based violence awareness and the challenging artistic activities. So this program has started to be implemented with great success in public schools in Nigeria. And of course, the final outcome of this program is to strengthen the idea of peace among students who experience violence and gender-related conflict experiences. So here I want to show you now some examples. So my recent program was a contribution of technology protection of health. Here we try to examine all the nuisance factors in an apartment in which is located in cities. And we created a model of the house, and the technology we used here, sensor detectors, sound detectors were installed, and the technology we used here was Arduino controllers, etc. And now I want to show you what happened. Here we have some art workshops with the Greek Astronomy Space Company using unplugged activities, how to build speedometer using the serial box. Simulation of asteroids hitting Earth, so how to build a telescope, constellations, solar lunar eclipses, supernovas, and all what happened with the plane with the problem that I mentioned about CERN. We had many challenging engineering challenges. You can see here the particle CMS detector as it is located at CERN. This is the inner structure. And this is what we have done. with my students of primary school. We created models of practice semester that are using a variety of techniques and materials. Here you can see with drinking straws, colleges, drinking straws and pills through jewelry, particle CMS detector, wooden representations of the CMS, 3D printing. This project lasted 100 for assembly, 100 for 3D printing. Many artistic representations, Large Hadron Collider, which is located at CERN, artistic representations of the particle detector CMS, particle collisions, also explosions. At the CMS exhibition, many of these models of the CMS detector using Lego. And here you can see Higgs boson artistic representation. Gastronomy and science, a new also tendency, new trend. Here you can see we have depicted the CMS detector as a dessert. The global sense of innovation, with 3D printing and art and painting. The sense markets of sense installations, portraits of famous scientists, and apart from women, from also here you can see Einstein models of the solar system and galaxies, history of the Big Bang, common faces, simulation of the CMS experiment with relative flash circuit, and let's say it's a secret. A presentation of the Atlas detector using the technique. Shadow and light. We use many digital tools, free digital tools. We create, for instance, a 3D timeline depicting all the events, all of the major events of particle physics till today. And here we can see how we use also HP reveal for augmented reality for mobiles and tablets. We created also a whole course of particle physics using the free CRAM platform through games, cards and games, at the CMS virtual gallery, faces of the moon using real cookies. And before concluding, I want to say that I am among the first educators on a global level that combine STEM education with language teaching. So some years before, I organized a very popular live show. It had a great impact all over the world. It was addressed to English language teacher. So the title you can see here is Science Says Not to Bullying. What happens here? We demonstrated a physics experiment. Here you can see a lemon battery. And why, for English language teachers, why? Here you can see an interactive worksheet. Students experiment with different materials, and at the same time, they learn English grammar. They say that if I use safety pin, will the ball light up? So at the same time, they perform the physics experiment, and they learn English grammar, conditionals in English grammar. So far we have physics and English grammar. Why bullying? Because here you can see five yellow lemons and one green lemon, which is the one who is a victim of bullying. So we degrade also sociology. And at the end, students do this, represented all this through a theatrical play. So this is the magic of STEM. In one project, you involve many cognitive disciplines. Here you can see physics, English, grammar, sociology, and theater and arts. This is the magic of STEM. I'm also teaching STEM volunteer to oncological hospital. He's interested to see how children with severe depression and terminal diseases, they light up when they engage in STEM activities. I'm also a volunteer for refugees and children with special education needs. I'm also the founder and co-founder of many international programs. Here you can see this program in two weeks, over 2,000 students, teachers were registered, and over 200,000 students were also participated. And this program took the dimensions of a revolutionary project around the world. It was the most successful STEM teachers. It is the most successful so far. And after this, I started to write the more humanitarian STEM projects in order to promote STEM in developing countries. Here you can see My challenge was to design STEM activities using only natural resources. So students there, although the fact that they didn't have any school supplies, they did amazing things. Here you can see my recent one, COVID and gender-based violence that I saw later. And also I had the chance to participate in the curriculum of Zambia. I was in London in order to design STEM mathematical activities. And there they told me this thing that you have to design activities. And remember that we're talking about students who do not have no pencil, do not have chalk, do not have paper. So this was a great challenge for me. Here in Greece, I'm working at the Greek Ministry of Education, the Directorate of Education, Technology and Innovation, where I wrote a new project, which is launched here in this academic year to all primary school students. And this is called as well, we're changing the Earth's climate. And it's original because it combines what I said before, STEM education, environmental awareness, and arts. For all this project, I have awards. I was selected among the best teachers in the world with the Global Teacher Prize, Global Teacher Award as a global icon and one of the most 100 most successful women in the world. Thanks a lot for your attention. If you have any questions, of course, I am at your disposal.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It was really insightful lecture. It was really informative and interesting. Now, I request the audience to kindly post their questions in the chat box. Ma'am, someone is asking, as you have mentioned, 39% of firms find it difficult in recruiting staff with STEM skills and knowledge over the last 12 months. So how can we bridge the gap of corporates and STEM skilled individuals?
Mm-hmm. Well, you said, I said before that we need, first of all, to start from gender norms. Education systems, and especially higher education system, play a central role in defining girls' interest in STEM subjects and providing them equal opportunities to access and benefit from this. So as I said before, the universities have a role to play because they need to inform them to conduct gender audits and they do organize many campaigns about this, many extra courses, extra curriculum activities, such as I said before, field trips, exposure to real world learning opportunities. Apprenticeships that really inspire and help retain girls' interest. Here in Greece, said before, we have many initiatives about girls' co-coding with great success. And we organize some festivals, science festivals, where you know girls are organizing their, have a stand and they present their work. They are dressed like scientists. Why this? Because we needed to remove all these gender social norms and these stereotypes that are perpetuating pre-existing disparities. And very important is mentoring. What I'm trying to do also, I have created this new organization, G100, and we have formed a group of volunteers. It's important to form this group of volunteers who act like mentors. I mean, these mentors could invite and visit schools and organize many events about science, especially for women. And at the same time, not only organize events teaching science, but also to support them morally, psychologically, you know, to have a more personal relationship with them. I mean that getting more girls and women into STEM education careers requires a holistic and integrated approach, responses. This is very important. We need to remove mathematical anxiety, as I said before, which is common among female learners. We can do also informative campaigns to parents, as I said before, that parents in many, many times influence students' careers and students' future. So another thing also is how to improve them ICT also skills through the organization, said before, of extra curriculum educational courses, etc. So what I said before is how it is important to organize many workshops for educators also, in order to help the teachers to enhance their scientific literacy, to help them with pedagogical skills, and especially to help women with the low levels of confidence. This is very, very important, how to help them with low levels of confidence, because women who have low confidence, they're unlikely to inspire their students later in STEM later careers. So this is what I believe. Extracurricular activities, exposing to real world opportunities, real world problems, and use of mentors and volunteers. It's very, very, I have seen the results about this.
Mom, someone has asked, you have won so many awards and honors. So what do you consider your greatest achievement?
Well, as I mentioned before, my greatest achievement was the humanitarian STEM project implemented in Africa and Asia. I think it's the biggest challenge, because how to teach STEM, which is hands-on activities by definition, and in most part entails computational thinking and technology equipment, it was the biggest challenge. And there I had to do many online courses with the students there, and show them some experiments, physics experiments online. I was surprised and amazed about how students there perform water experiments, for instance. All they did, I show you in the photo some amazing arts and crafts, with boats. They did many, many engineering challenges using only natural resources, such as what branches of trees. They created amazing mind maps using branches of trees. This is the most exciting part, I think, of my whole career. Because if you teach, for instance, computational thinking for technology, is something common that every teacher can do. But it's extremely difficult and challenging to design activities for the students there who don't have school supplies. Or India, I want to say something that I implemented a project which is called Food for Thought. It was implemented mostly in India. And it was STEM also, and it had a great impact to teachers there, because it inspired teachers to visit slums with underprivileged children. They educated the families, they gave them money, they donated them, and they educated them about the nutritional awareness. This was it was a great success and great reward for me. So I think that the most important moment in whole career was this program. I continue to write this program, and my recent one is about gender-based violence. Gender-based violence in Nigeria is you know, a very challenging topic. I mean that it's not easy to deal with. They have extremely high rates of violence there. So I need to come up with a concept totally original. And the majority of teachers there didn't know about STEM. So when I introduced all this philosophy of STEM education, they were very, very, very surprised, very, very amazed. And they did amazing things, many theatrical events. And they have also created a club there, a girls, a science club. It's very, very interesting for me from here in Greece to promote STEM to all these countries. It's very, very important for me.
That was really interesting to know. Saurabh Kumar has asked, how does STEM help in improving one's social skills?
Mm-hmm. Well, because when we try to implement STEM project, it's always about involving collaboration. We're talking about project-based learning. Problem-based learning, it means collaborative learning. It's impossible to implement something like this without separated, separating students into groups. It's very, very important. But, and as I said before, STEM education reflects the four C's: communication, collaboration, creativity, and critical thinking. You know, through trial and error, students, they try, if you give them an engineering challenge, for instance, to create a particle detector, as we have this particle SMS detector, they will work together. Through trial and error, they will go to find different solutions. They will discuss about what did wrong, what they have to change, why they had to formulate hypotheses together. They collaborate together. I mean that in STEM, I want to say this, that in STEM education, we give problems to our students. We don't give them solutions. If we teach environment, for instance, recently I taught environmental issues. I asked my students to create a meteorological weather station. I didn't give them any solution at all. They had to come up with a construction, an original construction that could solve a real life problem. And this could be collaborative work. When we talk about STEM, it's always about collaboration. This can happen. In this way, social skills can be developed. And also during the remote learning, many asked me how I implemented STEM workshops during social distancing. Social distancing is only physical. It shouldn't lead to isolation. I mean that we have many collaborative platforms. Bullying chats, we have interactive boards, blogs, forums, chats, all of these resources and media that we can leverage in order to help our students develop their social skills. During remote learning, during the COVID pandemic, I performed many online courses, STEM courses, although it's difficult because STEM education is hands-on. However, you can do it online also if you have the right methodology. You have created a manual, a tutorial with steps and instructions step by step. But remember, you need to leverage collaborative platforms in order to engage all students to work together. This is, I think, this is my opinion. STEM education, you can't talk about STEM without talking about social skills. They're very related.
Ma'am, there's one question. You have been working in promoting STEM education on an international level. In your experience, how can we provide STEM education to technological disabled or backward regions where even basic education is on question?
Mm-hmm. Well, as I said before, you know, unfortunately, STEM is a misleading curriculum so far. It's not integrated in all around the world. I think in Australia and USA is so far integrated. But, you know, there's a big progression. Here, for instance, in Greece, for the first time, our Minister of Education has announced a new discipline, which is called Labs of Skills, and there are 12 thematic sessions, and STEM robotics is included. So I think that this requires progressive, gradual efforts from policymakers, but at the same time, social perception of teachers. And you know, I had to teach here in Greece to many underprivileged children. This program with SEN was with underprivileged children. And then, you know, we didn't have the possibility of technological equipment. We didn't have the possibility of technology. So in this case, I wasn't discouraged because I chose to adopt what I said before, STEM Unplugged. STEM Unplugged is when you use materials that you can find in your house. For example, Lego, I saw you, colleges that we created, Lego cardboard. For instance, we did a workshop about a handmade solar heater, using also only cardboard, a hose, plexiglass, and water. It was absolutely functional, and also an hydraulic levitator, etc. They were absolutely functional, and children saw this way through this experiential learning and through this hands-on and learning by doing the principles the function of the solar heater only through this activity. So even in countries or in regions where is no possibility of technological infrastructure, teachers would have heart, brain, and soul. And in this case, I say again that we can leverage STEM Unplugged, which does not require necessarily a technology or programming or coding. There are many, many, especially in public schools, here in Greece also we have this problem with technology. We don't have rooms and technology with technology equipment in school classrooms. So we can adopt the first category again. I hope that this is a problem of funding for countries, but I hope that in the future, since now STEM is considered as the top priority of many countries around the world, in Europe and USA, they fund and sponsor only STEM projects, because as I said before, STEM is the future of education. And as I mentioned, engineering are highly paid jobs because highly demanded. Why? Because there is a lack of staff in this subject. So I think that it's very, very challenging, especially for women, to pursue these STEM pathways in order, of course, to earn more money, but also to have a great prestige and in order to prove to our world how women can be equal as men in order to in these science related careers. I want to tell you also about my this experience that when I started this program at CERN, I had this problem that there are many parents who believe that I am as a woman that I couldn't teach particle physics efficiently. So here, unfortunately, still in the 21st century, still there are these gender stereotypes about women in science-related careers. So we need you as students there, college, and you need to remove all these barriers and all the stereotypes by being dedicated and by choosing STEM-related paths in order to succeed, in order to innovate, in order to discover, in order to become brilliant scientists.
Okay, Mom. Ayush Mishra has asked, why do you think it is important to highlight the role of women in addressing the world's sustainable development goals?
Mm-hmm. Well, as I said before, the agenda, the United Nations 2030 agenda has the Sustainable Goal 5 for gender equality. And here it's very important because this encourages teachers to implement many projects, school projects in the classroom in order to engage students in this, in programs that promote gender equality. And as I said before, it's important why. I mentioned the program that I implemented, the most recent program, gender-based violence there. What was that inspired me there? I learned that many volunteers, women volunteers there who work for peace organizations, etc., they die every day. They die every day from domestic violence and gender violence. So I was shocked when I learned about all these numbers of gender-based deaths in Nigeria. And this case, this case, I tried to integrate STEM into my new program, because if I just implemented a single program, maybe I didn't have the same results. STEM is very original, very challenging, because it's hands-on. It has many, many opportunities for children to be creative. So this helped me in order to challenge to attract all the students and to start seeing this concept of gender-based violence differently. So STEM education is very, very important in order to promote sustainable development goals, especially, as I said before, in developing countries.
Ma'am, the next question is, what are the next big projects for Greek astronomy and space company?
Yes, I'm writing now an educational program about plasma physics and technology for students of 11 to 13 years old. And it's quite challenging because there are many, many concepts that we still don't know. It's collaboration with the Spaceship Foundation and Mount Space Foundation. And I'm very curious to see the results. It's going to be launched very soon in Italy, Milano schools. And there I'm trying to adopt STEM again methodology in order to teach plasma science and technology and especially space technology, these applications in space technology we're going to see. And of course, I forgot to mention that I also write books, scientific books for kids. My recent one was about astronomy for children of 5 years and above. And there I tried to use humoristic methods and original methods in order to transfer astronomical knowledge in order for this to, for my books to be more attractive to students of this age, so 5 years old. And as I said before, it's important to remember that students from an early age will be exposed to science according to recent research. That's why CERN, the European Organization for Nuclear Research, organized so many workshops for preschool age students. It's not accidental. This was also the concept about language teaching, that students who learn language, a new foreign language at an early age, they learn it better, they have a better pronunciation, and they learn to express easily. This is the same applies to science also, that students should be exposed to science and early. And you can know, parents can start from learning STEM at home. I mean, there are many platforms, global platforms all around the world, especially in USA, which STEM is very, very developed. You can find many activities with videos, with instructions. It's very important from this to start from parents and from home, the preschool age, according to this recent data, to make students love science at an early age. Because, you know, I said before how science as it is taught today is uninteresting and boring. And me also, as a student, I had physics teachers and I hated physics. The way it was taught, so we need all to remove all these traditional methods and try new ones, try new challenging activities, and new attractive methods.
Ma'am, there's one last question. As we are pursuing engineering, what do you advise to work on to help the art get into STEM industry?
Mm-hmm. Well, my advice is to believe in yourself and believe that what you do matters for science and society. Try to create networks. Network is very important. Find the peer support and mentoring that you need. And also, you need to be open and outspoken about the challenges you face to help others find better ways to support. You need, of course, to be also realistic. And you need to decide what things are worth fighting for and what others are not worth the time or energy. And you should not let any of the gender stereotypes which are thrown at that affect you. And also, I want to say that if you follow your dreams, then you will always succeed. Follow your dreams and your passion. This is